Dear GC GET audience, I'm Dr. Berza Şen Yılmaz from Turkey. In this webinar, we will focus on the concept of guiding the sequential eruption of the permanent teeth. We will first have a quick overview on the transition from primary dentition to permanent dentition, cite the factors causing crowding, learn how to perform the model analysis, and we'll talk about the guidance of eruption concept with and without extraction. The evolution of the occlusion. The deciduous or the primary dentition starts around the 6 months following birth. The lower primary incisors are usually the first to erupt, and by 2.5 years of age, the primary dentition is generally complete and in full function. It is important to know the characteristics of the normally developing primary dentition to understand the transition to permanent dentition. The presence of diastema between incisors in the primary dentition is necessary to provide enough space for permanent incisors eruption. The primate or anthropoid diastema is located distal to the upper laterals and distal to the lower canines. These spaces are inherited genetically from our ancestors and they are located opposite to each of the four canine teeth. These larger diastema provide room during lateral jaw movements for the canines that are significantly longer than the other teeth, especially in primates. The overjet and the overbite are more shallow compared to the permanent dentition. The upper incisors are more retroclined compared to its permanent counterparts, resulting in decreased interincisal angle. The arch form is ovoid. The anteroposterior dimension of the arch is shorter compared to the transversal width. The flash terminal plane is the normal molar relationship considering the second primary molars. There are three types of molar relationships considering the second primary molars in the deciduous dentition. The class 3 primary molar relationship is rarely seen in the primary dentition except severe skeletal discrepancies. It is important to know that the distal step in the primary dentition leads always to a class 2 molar relationship in the permanent dentition. The flash terminal plane relationship may result in class 1 or in class 2 permanent molar relationships. Finally, the mesial step may result in class 1 or in class 3 molar relationships. One more time, the chart representing the evolution of the occlusion. Generally, no significant changes occur in the dental arches between 3 years of age to 6 years of age. The mixed dentition starts with the eruption of the first permanent tooth. Dentition may be evaluated into two parts, early and late mixed dentition. Starting from the eruption of the first permanent molars or the permanent incisors, early mixed dentition generally ends around the age of 8 years. There is a lag phase between the early and late mixed dentitions. The late mixed dentition period comprises the eruption of the permanent canines and the premolars. The early mixed dentition starts with a specific period during which important changes occur. The transition from flush terminal plane to class 1 permanent molar relationship occurs progressively. The terminal plane relationship of deciduous molars, mesial shift of the molars with eruptive forces, and differential growth of the maxilla and mandible are factors providing the transition to class 1 permanent molar relationship. The mesiodistal width sum of the permanent incisors is greater than the mesiodistal width sum of the deciduous incisors. This difference is about 6 to 7 mm and means that there is obvious need for space for permanent teeth. Use of interdental physiologic spacing, increase in the intercanine width, increase in the anterior length of the arch width, and change in the inclination of permanent incisors are mechanisms providing space for permanent incisors eruption. In the second part of this webinar, we will discuss about the changes that follow during the mixed dentition. Guidance of eruption, part 2. In the second part of this webinar, we will discuss about the changes that follow during the mixed dentition. Following the early mixed dentition, there is a lag phase during which no important clinical changes occur. This period is also called the intertransitional period and lasts approximately 1.5 years. The late mixed dentition starts with the second transitional period. The second transitional period comprises the eruption of the permanent canines and premolars, eruption of permanent second molars, and finishes with the establishment of the permanent dentition. In contradiction with the incisors transition, the mesiodistal width of the canines and the premolars is smaller compared to their predecessors. This difference is called leeway spaces. The total of the right and left sides is 1.8 mm in the maxilla and 3.5 mm in the mandible. As the difference is larger in the mandible, this difference has crucial importance for the molar relationship to turn to class 1. To better understand how the transition occurs, let's talk about the tooth eruption in more detail. The pre-eruptive tooth movement is the movement of a tooth within the alveolar bone before appearing in the mouth. The eruptive movement starts from when the tooth is first seen till it reaches its final functional plane. The post-eruptive tooth movement is defined as the movement of a tooth to maintain its occlusal position while jaws and alveolar process continue to grow. In order to expect a normal developing occlusion, a favorable eruption tooth sequence has primordial importance. Additionally, adequate tooth-jaw size harmony and preservation of the leeway spaces are essential. In the maxilla, the first premolar is generally the first to erupt. The primary and the permanent tooth sizes are almost equal. The primary canine and the second premolar tend to exfoliate simultaneously, allowing the first permanent premolar to drift distally, providing space for the permanent canine. Although there is variability in the sequence of arrival of the teeth in the mouth, there is the generally expected order. All the mechanisms cited till now take place in normally developing patients. What are the factors causing developmental disturbances? Let's see what are the causes of disturbance in the development of teeth. The disturbances in tooth eruption may be effective in all of the developmental stages from the formation to the eruption of a tooth. Ectodermal dysplasia, total or partial anodontia, the presence of natal or neonatal teeth, or supernumerary teeth are the factors effective during tooth germ initiation period. Defects, variation in size or shape of the teeth, may occur during morpho differentiation period. Others affect the apposition of the dental heart tissues and the matrix formation. After the apposition of the heart tissues comes the calcification period. The enamel and the dentin might be in lack of calcification. Concrescence, retarded eruption, and ankylosis of one or multiple teeth may cause malocclusion. This was a quick overview of the developmental disturbances affecting teeth. Some of these factors, such as anodontia, presence of supernumerary teeth, or ankylosis, may cause malocclusions. The detailed description of the etiologic factors causing malocclusions will be discussed in the related webinar. We described in this part the normal transition from primary dentition to permanent dentition. We also cited the factors causing developmental disturbances of teeth. Now, time to decide if the occlusion is developing normally. In the next part of the webinar, we will talk about the need for space and the model analysis. Guidance of eruption, part 3. Let's discuss how to determine if there is space requirement. All orthodontic records are important for treatment planning, for patient follow-up, and for legal issues. The orthodontic records will be discussed in the specific webinar, but either plaster or digital, the models are essential diagnostic records to evaluate the occlusion. The purpose of performing the model analysis in the mixed dentition is to evaluate the amount of space available in the arch and to compare it to the required space for the eruption and settling of permanent teeth. To determine the size of the unerupted teeth in the alveolar bone, you can use the panoramic or periapical radiograph. First, measure the mesiodistal width of a tooth directly on the mouth or on the model. Measure the same tooth dimension on the X-ray and calculate the magnification coefficient. Then, you can measure the mesiodistal width of the unerupted teeth on the X-ray and calculate the real size with the help of the magnification coefficient. Sometimes the early extraction of the deciduous teeth may accelerate the eruption of the permanent teeth. In those cases, in which the arch is not developing symmetrically, you may use the mesiodistal width of the symmetric tooth already present in the arch. To determine the size of the unerupted premolars and canines, the other tool is to use the lower incisor's mesiodistal width. The correlation between the sizes of the mandibular incisors and the sizes of the cuspids and bicuspids in the maxillary and mandibular arches is high enough to make a prediction about the required space for the permanent teeth to erupt. But why mandibular incisors and not the upper ones? The upper incisors are not involved in the prediction methods, since they may show too much size variability and thus their correlation in size with other teeth is low. Moreover, they may be congenitally absent. There are many model analyses proposed for both the permanent and deciduous dentitions. We will have a quick overview on the Moyers and Tanaka-Johnson's analysis. Let's start with Moyers' prediction tool. Let's see how to perform the analysis in detail. First, measure the greatest mesiodistal width of each mandibular incisor. Then, mark on the model the point where the incisors would be if aligned. And finally, mark the point on the mesial surface of the first permanent molar. Now, time to measure the available space for the permanent teeth to erupt. The available space is between the incisor's alignment point to the first molar's mesial side. Let's use the lower incisor's mesiodistal width sum to predict the total mesiodistal width of the cuspids and bicuspids. This is also equivalent to the required space. The prediction of the cuspids and bicuspids size can also be done with Tanaka-Johnson's analysis. Tanaka and Johnson validated the probability charge by Moyer and proposed a simple formula to calculate the probable cuspid and bicuspid's mesiodistal width. The procedure starts the same way with Moyer's method. Measure the greatest mesiodistal width of each mandibular incisor. Divide the sum by 2 and add 11 for the upper and 10.5 for the lower teeth to estimate the width of cuspid and bicuspids in one quadrant. We mentioned till now how normally the transition occurs from deciduous to permanent dentition. We discussed also how to do the space analysis to decide whether there will be enough space for the permanent dentition or not. Now, time to talk about the guidance of eruption with or without permanent teeth extraction. We previously mentioned that the late mixed dentition starts with the second transitional period. During this phase, cuspids and bicuspids erupt and the occlusion adjusts accordingly. The guidance of eruption is performed during this specific period, aiming to allow a favorable eruption of the cuspids and bicuspids. The guidance of eruption is based on guiding the eruption of teeth with or without permanent teeth extraction. The aim of the guidance of eruption without extraction is to resolve small amounts of crowding by stripping the deciduous teeth's interproximal surfaces and using partially the leeway spaces. The indications for guidance of eruption without extraction are harmonic jaw relationships, small posterior crowding, no need large amount of molar mesialization, no dental or developmental anomaly. Let's see how to procedure progress. Stripping of lower primary canine's mesial side, extraction of the deciduous canines, stripping of lower first primary molar's mesial side, and eruption of the lower permanent canine. Extraction of the lower first primary molar, stripping of lower second primary molar's mesial side, extraction of the lower second primary molar, eruption of lower permanent bicuspids. We discussed how to perform guidance of eruption without permanent teeth extraction in this part. In the next part, the serial extraction or guidance of eruption with extraction will be explained. Guidance of eruption, part 4. The aim of the guidance of eruption with extraction is to resolve large amounts of crowding by extraction of the first permanent premolars. It is also defined as the planned sequential extraction of teeth to encourage the spontaneous correction of irregularities. But how to decide when to perform it? A French clinician, Robert Bounon, is the first to describe the procedure in the 18th century. Later, other clinicians named the procedure differently. 1.5 mm anterior crowding is considered as physiologic and requires no treatment. Crowding smaller than 4 mm might be treated without extraction. When crowding is between 4 to 7 mm, the case is considered as borderline. When the crowding is over 7 mm, extraction is highly advised. And when the crowding is more than 10 mm, there is obvious need for extraction. According to Regenberg, 7 mm and according to Profit, 10 mm are the limits to perform the serial extraction. End of the early mixed dentition, skeletal class 1 relationship, normally or slightly high angle growth pattern, normal or slightly decreased bite, normal or slightly protrusive dentoalveolar complex, no missing tooth, crowding more than 7 mm are the ideal conditions to perform serial extraction. The contraindications are class 3 skeletal malocclusion, cases that can be treated with incisors procrastination, missing teeth, and deep bite cases. The serial extraction is based on physiologic responses, so better soft tissue responses are expected. There are also psychological benefits. The serial extraction reduces the active treatment time, and shorter treatment provides better oral hygiene maintenance. Besides its benefits, the procedure has also some disadvantages, such as the lips may be affected negatively, there is long follow-up period, 2 to 3 years, and the bite increases. Several methods of serial extraction protocols in the literature. Dewell's method consists of 3 steps. It starts with extraction of the deciduous canine to resolve incisors crowding. Extraction of the first deciduous molar accelerates the eruption of the permanent first premolar, which is the last to be extracted. In the Tweets method, all deciduous molars are extracted around 8 years of age. 1 year later, the permanent first premolar is extracted with the deciduous canines. In Nance method, the extraction of the deciduous first molars is followed by the extraction of its precessor. Finally, the deciduous canines are extracted. After serial extraction, the patients often require short fixed treatment. The goals of the fixed orthodontic treatment following serial extraction are closing small gaps, correction of the axial inclinations, correction of the midlines, correction of the overjet and overbite, correction of the crossbite, providing better interdigitation, and finally coordination of the arches. Let's illustrate the guidance of eruption in the fifth part of the webinar. Guidance of eruption, part 5. Let's see a case in which guidance of eruption is performed with extraction. The patient was a 9-year-old female. She had repaired cleft palate. She had low smiling line. And she had a convex profile since both of her jaws were retrognathic. She had midline discrepancy and deep bites. She had class 2 molar relationship on the right and on the left sides. She had severe crowding on both arches. The class 2 patterns and the retreated jaw positions were validated with the cephalometric tracings. This case was for sure far from being the patient presenting the ideal indications for serial extraction, but she needed guidance of eruption since she had severe need for space for her permanent posterior teeth eruption. We decided to start with the upper permanent first premolars and lower deciduous first molars extractions. The extraction of the lower first premolars was performed together with lower deciduous teeth. These records are following extractions. You can see on this radiograph that the canines and the second premolars have now enough space to erupt. Follow the midlines. They almost completely autocorrected. At this stage, we started the active fixed treatment to correct the upper incisor's inclination. We placed a proclination utility arch together with a nickel titanium wire. We started leveling in the upper arch. To correct the cross bite, the patient used a removable bite plane for 2 months. The cross bite was then corrected. We extracted lower second deciduous molars and placed push coils to maintain the spaces. The second premolars started to erupt and they were included in the leveling arch. The case is still in the course of treatment. This is an example to explain how to guide the eruption before some teeth get impacted. Thank you for your attention.